Good morning and welcome from a beautiful sunny morning here in Storth, where we've been invaded with white fantail doves. Our four originals have just come back with their distant cousins, with our six at the back, and there's a right kerfuffle going on for feed. But it's heartening to see the old four doves that we released Pentecost Sunday come back after many weeks of being away. So it's a joyful day. So I hope you're having a good day today. And let us just be still now as we gather our thoughts and come into the presence of God. So we begin. Grounding ourselves and knowing that Jesus the Christ is here among us. And I light this light this morning, and if you have a candle nearby and you would like to light your light with this, brilliant, because this morning we're dedicating our prayers for the migrants in Calais, because tomorrow is D-Day, where many hundreds of migrants will be dispersed in different parts of France. And I know that it's going to be an ugly scene. So we pray for them, and we pray for the French police, the gendarmes, that they will show compassion and sensitivity, and also for the migrants. Amen. So our prologue for this Sunday morning reads, "We enter the eternal and infinite garden with reverence to the Heavenly Father, Mother God, the Earthly Mother, and all the great masters, and reverence to the holy, pure, and saving teaching, and reverence to the brotherhood and sisterhood of the elect. Sunday morning we commune with the Angel of Earth, saying, Angel of Earth, enter my generative organs and regenerate my whole body. As you say this, you contemplate the life-generating soil and the growing grass, feeling the currents of the Angel of Earth transforming his sexual energies into regenerative forces. So now we're going to be still and just spend a moment in silence and invite the Lord Christ into our hearts. I'm guided to read Psalm 62, which is the reading for this morning, but I want to find the modern version of it, if I may. Ah, here we are. As for me, my heart waits on God. I know that my salvation comes from Him. I may change my views about many things, but as for my need for God and God's love, that is one conviction which shall never change. There are many who would like to sabotage a man's deepest convictions. With the skillful use of words and logic, they try to destroy the very foundations of one's faith. As for me, my heart waits on God. God is my hope and my help. The temporal values that men focus on are so quickly lost amidst the tempests of this life. Their highest aspirations burst forth like bright flares, only to frizzle out like wet fuses. But my God offers a security that is eternal. It cannot be logically defined, but it can be experienced. Commit your life to Him today, and you shall discover an anchor that will hold firm despite the chaos of this existence or the prattle of godless intellectuals." I pray I'm not a godless intellectual. A beautiful reading that sings to the heart. Our next reading is from the little UCB booklet. And we began yesterday evening with personal growth. Well, now we have a follow-up with the second edition on personal growth. In the book of Proverbs, chapter 24, verse 5, we read, "A wise man has great power." Another indicator of your need for personal growth is losing interest in your career. Wow. Many people think this comes from staying in one job too long or experiencing a midlife crisis. The truth is, most of us lose interest in our job because we lose interest in growing. Consider those who experience the highest levels of intensity and creativity. Generally speaking, they're passionate about their job and they're not nearly as concerned about specifics as they are about the big picture. While those around them get bogged down in the minutiae of daily routine, growth-orientated people are busy swinging the bat and trying to hit the ball out in the park. These are people who are growing, learning and expanding their experience. People who never lose interest in their work or in life. Excuse me. Growing peanuts sounds pretty boring, right? Not to George Washington Carver. He studied them, developed them, and discovered hundreds of different uses for them, and became so famous he was invited to Washington, D.C., to explain the secret of his success to a congressional committee. And here's what he told them. God created the peanut, so I just asked him to tell me what could be done with it. And he showed me. It's that simple. Spend as much time expanding your knowledge and experience as you spend on the mundane, and see if your interest levels and excitement don't change for the better. And the Bible says, a wise man has great power, and a man of knowledge increases in strength. Well said. Excuse me. I've got a bit of a sore throat. We bless it. And now, guided to read something from Jesus' Corner. Leadership versus servanthood. In the Christian Gospel of St. Mark, chapter 10, verses 43 to 44, we read, "But whoever would be great among you must be your servant, and whoever would be first among you must be slave of all." In the eyes of the world, leadership is usually associated with power and prominence. It is often sought after by very egocentric people. Such people desire to be coddled, even idolized. They want authority and they enjoy lording it over their constituents. They want to be served by them. This is not so in Christ's kingdom. The kingdom of God is served and promulgated by those who serve others, whose leaders are those who become the servants of all. It is true. You are enjoined to follow Christ, to serve him, but this was possible only after he served you and his Father, Mother, God, by reconciling you to your Creator. As Jesus has been your servant, so you are made his servants, and you serve him by serving your brothers and sisters in the human family. This is especially true of those who are chosen to be leaders. Their greatness or effectiveness is determined by the quality of their servanthood. God sent Jesus to this world for the purpose of giving his life for you and for all the inhabitants of the planet. It is because of this that Christ is your leader and claims lordship over those who become his disciples. Those who are authorized to proclaim Christ's word and teach his precepts do so as his servants and they serve their fellow creatures in the process of doing so. Jesus has exhorted you who aspire to leadership to regard such servanthood as more important than your very lives, to carry out your service without concern for consequences, and with even less concern for accolades or accommodations. It is those who lovingly serve in this manner who, even without official appointment or recognition, become the real leaders in the kingdom of God. Let's stay with those beautiful readings we've shared with you, and we ask the Holy Spirit of God to speak to our hearts this morning. Breathe on us, O breath of God. Fill us with life anew, that we might love what thou dost love and do what thou wouldst do. Breathe on us. Breathe on the migrants and the gendarmes and all those officials tomorrow morning who will be responsible for clearing out all the migrants from their camp in Calais. Father, Mother God, be with each one of us here now as we come to celebrate your love for us. Amen. And now we come to our morning intercessions, and I'm going to take them from the traditional divine office for week two of the Psalter. Let us thank our Saviour who came into this world that God might be with us. Responds, we praise you, O Lord, and we thank you. We welcome you with praise. You are the day star, the first fruits from the dead. Let us rise with you to walk in the light of Easter. Response, we praise you, O Lord, and we thank you. Lord, we meet around your table as your family. Help us to see that our bitterness is forgotten, our discord is resolved, and our sins are forgiven. Response, we praise you, O Lord, and we thank you. We pray for all Christian and non-Christian families. May your Spirit deepen their unity in faith and love. Response, we praise you, O Lord, and we thank you. And this morning we remember all gathered here. We pray for our dear brother Richard and his immediate family. We pray for our dear sister Sue and her family. And we also pray for all the brothers and sisters of our community, and especially for those who may be unwell at this time. We pray for all our religious leaders of all faiths. We remember His Holiness the Dalai Lama, Thich Nhat Hanh, our Holy Father Pope Francis, and our reigning monarch Queen Elizabeth, head of the Church of England. We pray for all the men and women who have dedicated their lives to God. And we pray especially for those who may be vulnerable today. So let us now just hold each other in love as we bring into the circle of our prayer the vulnerable, the marginalized, the migrants of Calais, all the many refugees, all displaced persons, all those who inflict violence and woundedness on the children of God, and for the many who have asked our prayer. And we pray for Caroline, one of my Twitter friends, and for Brother Skip and Thomas Aquinas Q on Google, and the many, many friends who've supported us from the very beginning of our community. So let us be still now as we praise Almighty God for the gift of a new day, a new dawn, a new beginning, where we can dust ourselves down and just throw ourselves at the mystical heart of God inviting the Lord Christ back into our lives and saying, Lord, here I am. How may I be of service to you today? So let us now pray the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, Mother God, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our trespass, as we forgive all those who have trespassed against us. Lead us not astray, but protect us from the forces of evil, negativity, and despair. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And our closing prayer this morning is taken from the Divine Office, week 2. And here we go. Just bear with me. Right. The prayer is for the 30th Sunday of the Church's year. Lord God, deepen our faith, strengthen our hope, enkindle our love, and so that we may obtain what you promise, make us love what you command. We make our prayer through our Lord Jesus the Christ, who lives and who reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, forever and ever. Amen. And that, my dear friends, brings us to the end of Sunday morning prayer. If it's your bedtime, sleep well. If you're just beginning your day, have a wonderful day. And I pray that you've got clear blue skies wherever you may be, like we have here in Storth. So namaste, shalom, inshallah, pax et bonum, OmShanti, solo di caritas, salam alaikum, and may the peace of our God reawaken in your heart the need of those poor migrants in Calais as they struggle to go forward to some unknown destination where friendships will be dissolved tomorrow. And we blow out our light and we thank Almighty God for all the blessings that you and I have received and will receive this day. Amen. So again, thank you for being here, and I look forward to your company this evening, where I'll be leading Vespers. But have a lovely day.